Hi Disruptors, my name is Francisco Costa and I would like to welcome all of you to our first video on our OutSystems Architecture video series. This video series is going to be composed of 7 different videos, starting at the most basic concepts about OutSystems Architecture, moving on to more complex ones, and wrapping things up at the end with a webinar where we will answer all your questions and go through everything that was discussed in the videos. Whenever I discuss or teach about OutSystems Architecture, I always like to start with a very simple question. Why is architecture so important? Whenever I ask this, I usually like to give real-life examples on good and bad architecture practices. For example, on this slide on your left, you will see that things weren't really planned. So you get the door that is not on the floor level or a window that is crooked. On the right side, on the other hand, you will see two amazing buildings because everything was planned since the beginning. Hence, you get these amazing results at the end. The same principles apply to OutSystems architecture. If you don't plan your architecture of your applications, then you will get something like on the left that is disorganized and not very functional. But if you take your time and plan everything ahead of time and prepare for the future, you can get an amazing result like on the right side. OutSystems gives us a tool that helps us fight this, and that is the architecture canvas. The architecture canvas is composed of 4 layers for versions prior to version 11 and 3 layers from version 11 since screen references are now considered weak references. This architecture canvas is going to help you modulate your entire applications in order to get your modules on the correct spot and maintain referential integrity and everything functioning properly in your applications. The architecture canvas is composed by 4 layers. The first one is the orchestration layer, followed by the end user layer, then you have the core layer, and at the end you have the library layer. The architecture canvas helps you out a lot with the reusability of your modules and code, the scalability of your applications, the maintenance of everything that you develop, and in reality is just going to help with the application lifecycle. Not only this, but if everything is well placed, it also helps with team development, since it's going to be easier to get new people in and accustomed to the way that things are built. If you feel that the 4 layers, or 3 in the case of version 11, don't give you enough information, you can get into a little bit more detail by moving on to the next layer, which are the sublayers. For example, the orchestration layer is composed by only one sublayer called the orchestration, and this is where you'll have all your modules that mash up several frontends into a seamless user-friendly experience module. Then, moving on to the next layer, we'll have only the end user sublayer, and this is where you'll have all your frontend user interface modules. Moving on to the next one, the core layer is where things get a little bit trickier. You'll have 5 sublayers, which are the core, the APIs, the core services, the core widgets, and the composite logic. The core is where you'll have reusable services built around business concepts, exporting entities, business rules, or web blocks. This is the module that will contain all of these parts. Then, if you look at the APIs, the modules are just APIs to expose your core services. The core widgets and core services are, as the name indicates, modules built for that. And at the end, you'll have your composite logic, which are modules that are reusable business logic concepts around them, or synchronizing data. Now, moving on to the last layer, you'll have the foundation layer, which is composed by 4 sublayers: the foundation, the style guide, the foundation services, and the library. The foundation are non-functional requirements or integration modules. Then moving on to the style guide, this is a little bit more UI oriented and you will have reusable UI patterns, themes, and theme templates. The foundation services are, as the name indicates, integration services with external entities. And at the end you'll have the library, which are reusable libraries and plugins. After analyzing all the layers and sublayers, I always like to draw a comparison between this and a car. So for example, we have our foundation layer that serves as the basis, and this is like the car chassis. This is where every piece of the car is going to be built on. Then we move on to the core. This is where we'll have all our functional parts. So for example, our motor, our wheels, our electrical part of the car, and this is just everything that the car cannot run without. Then we move on to the last two layers, which are the orchestration and the end user, and this is just the body parts, basically the external look of the car. I think that this is an extremely good example because sometimes you have extremely good looking cars on the outside, then you open up the hood and everything is a little bit of a mess. This can also happen in out systems. You can have really well built screens, but then everything below them are not respecting architectural references and everything is not well designed. And this is why Architecture Canvas is so great, because it gives you a set of validation rules that you can use in order to maintain the sanity and good architecture of your application. And we're going to take a look at them now. So on this slide, you have two versions of this set of validation rules, one for versions prior to version 11 and another one for version 11. So on the left here, let's start with versions prior to version 11. We cannot have any upward references, so that means that foundation layer modules cannot reference any modules above them. Then we should not have any cyclic references. This is also a big no-no. And there should not be any side references between end user modules. Now, two small notes for the core layer. You should never have front-end servers on them, and your entities should always be read-only. If you need to expose some write operations, you should always build your own CRUD operations. Now, moving on to the library modules, you should have no business logic here and no core entities. Most of the same principles apply to also to version 11. The only different thing is that since we no longer have the orchestration layer because that screen references are now considered weak references, you just cannot have any strong references between end user modules. After checking all the validation rules, I always like to take a more practical approach to the problems. See how we can detect these issues and solve them. So on the next slide, we'll have five modules, two end user modules called A and B, two core modules called C and D, and one library module called E. Now, right off the bat, we see that we have an upwards violation from E to A, and then this is also causing two cyclic violations from A, C, and E to A, D, and E. The way that you can fix this is by checking what is it that you are referencing on module E that comes from module A. And since E is a library module, then that means that whatever is on A that E needs, it can probably go to E. So the way that I would approach this is first check what is on A that E needs, see if E can have it all on his side and A can consume from E, or if I need to find a solution that requires an extra module. The only violation that I don't have on this case is the strong references between end user modules. So at least we don't have to fix that one. That's it for today. Thank you all for watching. On the next lesson, we're going to be talking a little bit into more detail on the orchestration and end user layers. Thank you all for watching. Follow us on LinkedIn to keep updated to all our news, and see you soon.